frequently asked questions about amenorrhea. What is the difference between primary and secondary amenorrhea? Primary amenorrhea is defined as the failure to reach menarche. Evaluation should be undertaken if there is no pubertal development by 13 years of age, if menarche has not occurred 5 years after initial breast development, or if the patient is 15 years or older. Secondary amenorrhea is characterized as the cessation of previously regular menses for 3 months or previously irregular menses for 6 months. In contrast, a normal menstrual cycle typically occurs every 21 to 35 days. What are the common causes of amenorrhea? Primary amenorrhea is often, but not exclusively, the result of chromosomal irregularities that lead to primary ovarian insufficiency, for example Turner syndrome, or anatomic abnormalities, for example Mullerian agenesis. Most pathologic cases of secondary amenorrhea can be attributed to polycystic ovary syndrome, hypothalamic amenorrhea, hyperprolactinemia, primary ovarian insufficiency, or hypothyroidism. Is the clinical evaluation of primary and secondary amenorrhea similar? The initial evaluative steps are similar. In all cases, pregnancy should first be excluded. However, a major difference is the need to determine the presence or absence of the uterus in patients with primary amenorrhea. It is important to consider all causes of secondary amenorrhea in the evaluation of primary amenorrhea. What are some simple questions in the history that can help to exclude some of the common causes of amenorrhea? Patients should be asked about eating and exercise patterns, changes in weight, medication use, and chronic illness. What specific findings in the physical examination should attention be paid to? The physician should measure the patient's height, weight, and body mass index, and perform thyroid palpation and anastaging. Breast development is an excellent marker for ovarian estrogen production. Acne, virilization, or hirsutism may suggest hyperandrogenemia. Genital examination may reveal virilization, evidence of an outflow tract obstruction, or a missing or malformed organ. Dysmorphic features such as a webbed neck or low hairline may suggest Turner syndrome. What is the initial laboratory evaluation? The initial workup includes a pregnancy test and serum luteinizing hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, prolactin, and thyroid stimulating hormone levels. If history or examination suggests a hyperandrogenic state, serum free and total testosterone and dehydroepiandrosterone sulfate concentrations are useful. If the patient is short in stature, a karyotype analysis should be performed to exclude Turner syndrome. If the presence of endogenous estradiol secretion is not evident from the physical examination, for example breast development, serum estradiol may be measured. A complete blood count and comprehensive metabolic panel may be useful if history or examination is suggestive of chronic disease. When is imaging indicated? Pelvic ultrasonography can help confirm the presence or absence of a uterus, and can identify structural abnormalities of reproductive tract organs. If a pituitary tumor is suspected, magnetic resonance imaging may be indicated. What is the key to diagnosis of anatomical abnormalities like Mullerian agenesis? Mullerian agenesis, a condition characterized by a congenital malformation of the genital tract, may present with normal breast development without menarche, and may be associated with urinary tract defects and fused vertebrae. Other congenital abnormalities that may cause amenorrhea include imperforate hymen and transverse vaginal septum. Physical examination, as well as ultrasonography or MRI, is key to diagnosis, and surgical correction is usually warranted. What clinical and laboratory features will suggest primary ovarian insufficiency? Primary ovarian insufficiency, a condition characterized by follicle depletion or dysfunction leading to a continuum of impaired ovarian function, is suggested by a concentration of follicle-stimulating hormone in the menopausal range, confirmed on 2 occasions separated by 1 month, and diagnosed in patients younger than 40 years with amenorrhea or oligomenorrhea. What are the causes of primary ovarian insufficiency? More than 90% of cases unrelated to a syndrome are idiopathic, but they can be attributed to radiation, chemotherapeutic agents, infection, tumor, empty cellar syndrome, or an autoimmune or infiltrative process. Turner syndrome is the most common congenital cause. What is the management for primary ovarian insufficiency? Patients with primary ovarian insufficiency should be counseled about possible fertility, because up to 10% of such patients may achieve temporary and unpredictable remission. Hormone therapy until the average age of natural menopause is usually recommended to decrease the likelihood of osteoporosis, ischemic heart disease, and vasomotor symptoms. For optimal bone health, patients with primary ovarian insufficiency should be advised to perform weight-bearing exercises and supplement calcium and vitamin D intake. What clinical and laboratory features will suggest functional hypothalamic amenorrhea? It is characterized by a low estrogen state without other organic or structural disease. Laboratory tests usually reveal low or low normal levels of serum follicle-stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, and estradiol. Patients with functional amenorrhea may demonstrate the features of the female athlete triad, which consists of insufficient caloric intake with or without an eating disorder, amenorrhea, and low bone density or osteoporosis. What are the causes of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea? Functional hypothalamic amenorrhea occurs when the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis is suppressed due to an energy deficit stemming from stress, weight loss, excessive exercise, or disordered eating. What is the treatment for functional hypothalamic amenorrhea? Treatment of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea involves nutritional rehabilitation as well as reductions in stress and exercise levels. Menses typically return after correction of the underlying nutritional deficit. What are the causes of elevations in serum prolactin? Prolactin levels can be elevated because of medications, pituitary adenoma, hypothyroidism, or mass lesion compromising normal hypothalamic inhibition. Elevated prolactin levels, whatever the cause, inhibit the secretion and effect of gonadotropins, and warrant MRI of the pituitary. What are the diagnostic considerations in hyperandrogenic amenorrhea? Late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia, androgen secreting tumor, and Cushing syndrome must be distinguished from PCOS in the evaluation of hyperandrogenic amenorrhea. A high serum 17-hydroxyprogesterone level measured at 7 mg suggests congenital adrenal hyperplasia, which can be confirmed with an adrenocorticotropin stimulation test. An adrenal or ovarian tumor should be considered with rapid onset of symptoms or when serum androgens are significantly elevated. Rarely, hypercortisolism from Cushing syndrome may result in amenorrhea, and can be evaluated by a dexamethasone suppression test when stigmata of disease are present.
Audio Jungle. Audio Jungle.